Hey guys, I'm Janek Gwizdala. Thank you so much for voting on what this video was going to be about. I sent out this survey last week, you guys. Hundreds and hundreds, in fact, a couple of thousand of you voted on what this video should be about. And of course, what our new 12-week course of video bass lessons should be covering. There were five choices. There were a bunch of other choices as well, which you guys filled in, which is awesome. That means I have so much material to make so many more videos about, which is cool. But the winner, and not by the largest of margins, was chords and reharmonization, bass chords, chordal technique and reharmonization. So that's what this course is going to be about. The close second place was bebop vocabulary. So I think that's going to be our next 12-week course. So look for that in about 3 months. I'll be building a course around bebop vocabulary. Very quickly, before we get going, if you haven't already, subscribe to the YouTube channel. Very important, so you get to see all these videos as soon as they come out. And this coming Sunday, I am doing a free webinar, so you guys can jump online, tune in, ask me a ton of questions. I'll be around for about an hour this coming Sunday. If you're not on my mailing list, go to this link right here underneath my finger. Go to this link. Click on that link and sign up for the mailing list, and then you'll get all the emails and all the information about when that is taking place and how you can view it and how you can be a part of it. And of course, we're running, because we're starting a new course on Friday, we're running a special. We're giving a 25% discount on monthly membership to videobasedlessons.tv. So you can click this link right here if you want to find out more about that. But let's get on to chords and chordal kind of vocabulary and reharmonization. The 12-week course is going to be split, and I have notes here because I do not want to miss anything. I want to cram it all into this video because I've kind of laid out the way the course is going to be constructed. It's going to be in four different sections. We're going to be covering chordal technique, basic chordal vocabulary. You know basically to have some of this language under your fingers before you get into the third part of the course, which is intro to reharm. And then the last part of the course is constructing chord sequences, making your own chord sequences, how to use melodies and bass notes and inner moving parts and all those things. So by the end of the 12 weeks, you should have a really good handle on how to play, not just how to play chords, but how to create your own sequences. I'm starting out with a four string. If you've seen any of my videos before, you know I'm all about the fundamentals, and it's never too late to remind you about those. I have to remind myself about them all the time. And here is the first exercise I always give people, or tell people to, hey, you should check this out if you're getting into chords, if you haven't done too much of it already. It's really simple, and I'm not going to hang around too long on it. I just want to make sure you have this in the back of your mind, or perhaps the front of your mind if you haven't done it in a while. It's a major scale. I'm doing it in G here on the four string, a straight major scale with the tenth in the melody. So, and of course, I'm changing the quality of the chord depending on the degree of the scale I'm on. So in a major scale, it's major, minor, minor, major, major, minor, minor, major. I'm also, in this case, playing the root with my second finger and the tenth with my fourth finger all the way up. I'm not changing it. So I highly recommend you do that with all combinations on the left hand. You might have heard me talk about this before. Like I said, it's never too late to carry on, to keep working on this stuff and to revisit it. It's just going to stand you in great stead if you come and take this course, or if you start to work on chords of your own accord right now because of this video. These basic things are really going to help your flexibility in the left hand and your ability to find inner moving parts and moving melodic parts and moving root parts and all of these things. Just having control of a major scale with the tenth in the melody. So like I said, that's a super basic thing, but a really fundamental aspect for me about playing chords on any bass. You know what? I'm going to be doing this entire video on the four string, but throughout the 12-week course, I'll do stuff with the five string with a high C, and of course the five string with the low B. So kind of everyone gets catered to, and no matter what your stringing is, even if you have a six string, all the stuff with the high C will relate to you. For the most part, it will be with the four string, because there's just so much scope. You know, there's so many chords you can get out of just playing on a four string. It doesn't have to be all fancy and high C with extra range. It doesn't have to be. I choose that because I really like the extra range, but we're going to get so much mileage out of just the four string over the course of the 12 weeks. So first exercise I always give people is that one, is the major scale with the 10th in the melody. Super simple. The next thing I really I like to do in terms of exercising, in terms of getting the left hand really, really fluid, is to take one melody note, in this case it's going to be this B flat right here, and walk down chromatically. I have a bass line to create a two note chord, and I'm going to start on C on the A string. So I have B flat in the melody with my fourth string on the left hand, and I have C as our root note, as our bass note, which creates the chord. It's two notes, so a chord can be 15 notes as far as I'm concerned, but it can also be two. So we're starting off simple and really hopefully improving the flexibility in your left hand in terms of making all these chord shapes. So all I'm going to do is leave the melody note the same and walk down chromatically from C. And this is what it sounds like. And that last one, a little bit of a stretch. I would never put my thumb over there like an acoustic bass player. I'd just go and play it back up the octave to complete the chromatic scale. But that's it, that's the exercise. Now this is just giving you the ability and the muscle memory in your left hand to play every single possible root option with one melody note. So when we get into taking melodies and reharmonizing them, it won't be that difficult. If you've practiced exercises like this, it won't be that difficult for you to find F sharp with that B flat, or A flat, or the octave, or the D flat with the B flat in the melody. All of those things will be available to you, rather than that thing of, oh, well, I haven't really done this before, I wonder where B is, and it's right there. It will be way easier if you've worked, and not quickly either, just walking down the chromatic scale and feeling out all of those positions with the left hand. And like I said, it's getting to be a little bit of a stretch even on the D, so maybe you come up the octave to finish the sequence, just as long as you're rolling around that chromatic scale in the bass line. That's the first part of that exercise. Second part of that exercise, to really really get the fingers working and the mind working as well, is to alternate the melody notes. So now I'm going to have B flat and G, and I'm going to alternate the melody note every time I change my chromatic bass note. And there I am again. It's way simpler is way simpler than to explain it. So again, the bass line didn't change. The bass line is still that chromatic run of notes from C down to C, and we're alternating this kind of ostinato pattern between B flat and G. Every quarter note, if you think about it in quarter notes, one, two, three, and. And it really gets you thinking. It gets the left hand moving. It gets you. Now, like I said before, when we were doing this major scale thing, if you only do it with two fingers on the left hand, and you don't practice the three and four as opposed to the two and four, then when you come to do an exercise like this, you're gonna come a little bit unstuck, and it's gonna take you a little longer to get it down. But right there, being able to find that. Our three and four shape, when I have the B flat in the melody and the G flat in the bass, and then moving down to F in the bass and G in the melody. These are all just many, many combinations, a lot of them intense when we play this exercise, of different fingers on the left hand. So one and two, two and three, three and four, one and four, two and four, as many combinations as possible. So the fundamental exercise really bleeds into the slightly more complex exercise of playing the ostinato with the descending bass note. So now you have two exercises, well, kind of three really, once you've got the major scale and then the chromatic bass line with the melody note staying the same, and the chromatic bass line with the melody note changing as an ostinato. And this is just these notes that I selected for the purpose of this video. Do it in it, all over the instrument. Why not? Why not have the melody note as C and A? It doesn't have to be B flat and G. Really try and experiment all over the instrument. Now, playing all over the instrument is something I get asked about a lot in terms of, I get asked a lot, hey, your chords, they sound really well voiced. What are those intervals? I get those kind of questions when people hear me play chordally. And it's really important to understand what things sound good. You know, now of course that's kind of subjective. You know, what I think sounds good, you might not think sounds good. But there are some general rules of thumb in terms of where an interval might sound muddy. You know, the interval of a third, if you play it all the way in the bottom of the instrument, doesn't sound as good as when you play it up high in the instrument, and then. And even here, it sounds there's a lot more clarity to it than in the low end. That's not to say there isn't a place for that kind of chord. Maybe if you played it very subtly and very quietly, and it was maybe at the end of a piece, and it was just a subtle addition to something else that was already happening in the orchestration. So there are all those things to think about. I think one of the most fundamentally important things about any of this, whether we're talking about chords or melodies or solos or rhythm, the most important thing to me is to be listening to all this stuff and listening for all this stuff. If you're specifically trying to get into chords, really be checking out music that has chords. Most music does have chords, and check out people you like playing chords. For me, it was Herbie Hancock and Chick Corea and Keith Jarrett and, you know, great guitar, you know, John Scofield, some of these quirky chords he would play. And it was things like that that inspired me to dig deeper into the music and to really go out and listen to that stuff and find stuff I didn't understand. That was the most important thing. Find stuff I love and that I didn't understand. And as soon as there's something I don't understand, I go after it and I try and dig in, like, okay, so what's this interval? What are these inner moving parts? What's the melody? How are they playing the inner moving parts? Where's the bass line moving? Like, all of these elements that we've kind of been talking about in this video, I go and look for in real life versions of performance of this. You know, I might hear something at a concert, might hear something on a recording, but at the end of the day, it's listening to that and repetitive listening, like listening over and over and over and over again, so the melodic ideas start to become natural to you, so the root motions start to become natural to you, so you can recognize things in other music. Or rather when, you know, a big step for me was when I could start to recognize root motions and harmony in other music, I started to be able to hear that naturally while I was playing and be able to shape and push the music I was playing and really sort of dictate, you know, not in a kind of a bullyish way, but to have those options to dictate where the harmony goes and be able to hear multiple layers of harmony. So these are all things we're going to be covering in the course. You know, a couple of things, you know, like I said before, having the interval of a third, like that low in the bass, isn't necessarily going to sing out the most. At the same time, having, sometimes for me, having the intervals too far apart, also doesn't speak very, very loudly to me. So there are all these things to consider. And it, at the end of the day, it really comes down to what you like, what I like, what we all like as individuals, and how we can translate that to our instrument. And more importantly to me, like the most important thing to me is how I can translate all that stuff that I hear to my own music. Because there's so much of this, especially when we talk about chords and reharmonization, that is that's compositional. And that's huge. You know, there are... In fact, let me put a little delay on here. You know, I've been working on some things, breaking up chords. And I normally do this on the five string and in a different key, so I'm trying to transpose it right now on the spot, but some very beautiful, you know, some really simple ideas. Everything I played there was super simple. We're going to be covering all of those ideas of inversions of, you know, that, for instance, this is in G minor, so I was just using inversions of a minor chord as one element of that composition. So playing G minor in the root position, in the first inversion, and in the second inversion, that's all just G minor. That's all the same three notes just shifted around the instrument, and it can sound great on a four-string bass. You don't have to have that high C, like a lot of my playing is with the high C. You don't have to have it to make those sounds. And then moving, just by simply using the one chord and the four chord, for instance. In this case, the one chord is G minor, and we have three different versions of G minor, all the same three notes. Then I'm going to go to the four chord, which is C minor, and play the same idea, the root, the first inversion, and the second inversion in C. And then how about a five chord, D? Exactly the same thing, root, third, and fifth, just in different inversions. So that's first inversion, root, and second inversion, going to first inversion of G minor, to root of G minor, to second inversion of G minor. So these are very, very simple concepts, all of which we're covering in the 12-week course at videobassedlessons.tv, that can really add so many great elements to your vocabulary and to your playing. So I'm Janek Gwizdala. This is the start of our, this is our little preview, our free preview of our 12-week chordal and reharmonization course at videobassedlessons.tv. Don't forget to click the link right here if you want to take advantage of this discount. It's now, what is it, Wednesday today, this week, Wednesday through Sunday. Sunday is when we're going to shut it down. We're giving a 25% discount on monthly membership. So if you want to come and join us and check out the course, please do. If not, don't forget to subscribe to this YouTube channel, and you'll get all of these free videos as and when, immediately, not as and when, immediately when they come out. And like I said before, if you want to be a part of the webinar this coming Sunday morning in California time, at least, wherever you are in the world, you can come and be a part of it for free. Join in the chat, ask me questions, and I'll try and get to as many people's questions as I possibly can. But I'm Janek Gwizdala, and this has been Chords and Reharmonization.